and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where the box office conversation finally changed. And it was Lionsgate who changed it. Lionsgate! Yes, the former, emphasis on former, belle of the mini majors. Now, as you might recall, Lionsgate first became a Hollywood player when it acquired Summit, becoming the home of Twilight, Hunger Games, and interestingly, people forget this, but not Lionsgate, the talent who legitimately first put them on the map, Mr. Tyler Perry. Now, obviously, all three of those franchises have seen better days, and Lionsgate itself was on the verge of being acquired just last year. But when it wasn't acquired, the mini-major realized it had to rally and brought back the former head of its motion picture group, Joe Drake. I had to check out that name because I've never heard of the guy before, but we know who he is now, right? Who had left in 2012 and had thought he was going upwards, but ended up making a lateral move, and that's being polite. But anyway, he's back now, and Lionsgate also hired a new head of marketing, Mr. Damon Wolf. Now, sure, these are the same people who just fell flat on their face with Hellboy. Longshot is a financial failure, and Robin Hood, well, that was just plain embarrassing. But history is written by the winners, and Lionsgate this weekend is a big winner. So yes, John Wick 3 is the mini-major's biggest opening since the days of Hunger Games and Twilight. No disrespect to Mr. Perry, he's more of a distance runner than a sprinter, and while his biggest opening to date, it was a while ago, but you know, it was $41 million, he's still, I think, a consistent performer for Lionsgate, emphasis on consistent, as he's now made 19 movies for the mini-major. Anyway, with the successful debut of John Wick 3, edging out big brand competitors like Shazam and Detective Pikachu. Sure, it was just bigger by a million or two, but it was bigger. Lionsgate has proven that they're still an option for filmmakers looking to make a name for themselves, instead of just a place where talent goes when their career is on its last legs. If they're like a Hail Mary pass to try and make, you know, to get some traction going. It's like, I think before, or like recently, Lionsgate, the situation was, do you want your movie released theatrically or not, right? That was the positive spin on it. Like, sure, Lionsgate's releasing your movie, but at least your movie's getting released. But of course, that's not the situation anymore. They'd have to repeat this success fairly soon to make this not just all about John Wick, but you know, that's the Hollywood game, and I'm sure Lionsgate is working on that as we speak. I'd also like to point out that before they imploded it, Lionsgate was keen to get into the theme park business, you might also recall, with the Hunger Games. Of course, that never panned out. But I think that moviegoers become theme park visitors, and I think they'd be very interested, I know I would be, in a John Wick stunt spectacular. They're also thinking of doing that Continental TV show. They had a Fortnite crossover to promote the movie. Fortnite's getting a lot of movie money these days. But I think there's a lot that Lionsgate can do with the John Wick brand. It's a delicate dance. You don't want to overexpose it either, but you also you want to strike while the iron is hot. So I'll be curious. Look for interesting deals to come out of this, I think, and don't just think about on screen. That's what I'm saying. If I were Lionsgate, tomorrow morning I'd be making calls to theme parks saying, would you like a John Wick stunt show? And if I were that theme park, I'd be like, yes, please. I love theme park wars as much as I love Hollywood wars. All right, and this isn't just good news for Lionsgate, by the way. It's the kind of success that can be a game changer for all involved. Keanu Reeves? Yeah, I'm thinking he's back. Halle Berry? A new lease on her career. She's no longer... Storm won an Oscar, right? I mean, I think there will always be an element of that there, but I think she could at least, I think, rack up a couple more choice cameos like this, you know, and other B, well, I don't think it's fair to call John Wick a B movie anymore. In fact, it's an A-minus movie, as you'll see from its cinema score, but you know the kind of movie where they have an actor show up for a couple of scenes. Ian McShane, it's his whole career, it's his whole business model. So Halle Berry, I think, could jump on that too. And I have to say, on a side note, I'm very happy that women are kind of starting to get this situation as well. Before, it was always older male actors, but, you know, Halle Berry, Emma Thompson's cleaning up in this department now, like almost like the female equivalent of Liam Neeson, and in fact, they're in Men in Black International together. I think it's really a fabulous development. Mark Dacascos, I saw John Wick 3 again last night, and I was like, isn't Marvel making a little movie called Shang-Chi? Won't it need supporting cast members and a villain or two? I would definitely, if I were... Kevin Feige, I would be definitely interested in Mark Dacascos. As for the stunt community, this movie has generated genuine conversation about recognition at the Oscars. Before, it was always about the stunt community being like, let us in, and the Oscars were like, no. But now I think the Oscars are like, maybe we should, or, you know, at least this is a conversation we should start actually having. And it also proves, along with Tom Cruise's Mission Impossible franchise, that actors doing many, I want to be fair, they don't do all of their own stunts, but many of their own stunts does make a difference to audiences and at the box office. I wonder how Tom Cruise feels about this, because I think Keanu Reeves is giving him a run for his money. I think they aren't as crazy as Tom Cruise's stunts, obviously, but still, Tom Cruise is no longer the only actor in the stunt game. Furthermore, this also proves that the mid-range movie ain't dead. John Wick 3, for instance, cost just around $50 million to make, not including advertising, but still, that's a sweet spot for a budget. So if you have a good enough hook, that this is important, that convinces audiences your movie is worth seeing in theaters, the mid-range movie can compete. Really compete. It's the number one movie of the weekend, unseated Avengers Endgame. And make no mistake, I think that John Wick's strength isn't just its amazing stunt work and fight choreography, but also that it's a strikingly beautiful film as well. See what happens when you make an effort, Hollywood? And speaking of making an effort, this must be incredibly satisfying for Chad Stahelski, Keanu's stunt double on The Matrix, that's how they met, to have his first number one opening as a director, see his franchise move to the summer, and to be the one to topple again Avengers Endgame from that top spot. All on his own terms, by the way, with a celebration of the skills, stunt work that got him into the movie business in the first place. He's not only giving back to his community, but proving that they are an artistic community, that they have really truly something to contribute cinematically, which I think is really important in getting, again, as I said, more respect for the stunt community. And I think this is also great that it proves that there are multiple paths to the director's chair. I mean, this is like when the production designer Robert Stromberg got to direct Maleficent. I wish he'd continued to direct. I don't think that movie should have killed his career, but still, you know, it's not just writer than director. There's other ways to get there. Ava DuVernay, marketing executive, she had her own business, to director. You just have to have a good enough and unique enough idea, which Chad Stahelski certainly has. To be fair, he, you know, started this with David Leitch, who's his career is going forward much faster than Chad Stahelski's, but I hope that Chad Stahelski starts to get the respect that he deserves as well. I wanted him for the Suicide Squad 2 gig, as you might recall, and many of you were like, that's a great idea, and we now talk about it all the time whenever Chad Stahelski comes up, or Suicide Squad comes up. But I think it's clear that Chad Stahelski wants to make more John Wicks, and make more John Wicks he shall after this opening weekend, but I would like to see him start to get some other offers. I think he deserves to operate outside. I mean, he's proven himself in his own sphere. I think now he needs to level up to be a part of the group. And while John Wick 3 earned an A- cinema score, and there's obviously some moviegoers who haven't checked it out yet, it could have done a bit better with the under 25 set, and its diversity numbers are okay. But this can be a plus, because you can try and reach out to those audiences and say, you know, this core audience really liked it, maybe you should check it out too. But John Wick has a number of box office assassins headed his way. TikTok indeed, Mr. Wick. As for Avengers Endgame, it unseated Avatar domestically. So close, not the headline you wanted this weekend, which might be its final milestone, by the way. It's unlikely to unseat The Force Awakens as the number one domestic film, and it's still about $200 million behind Avatar worldwide. As I said last week, it's going to be a photo finish, but I don't know. It's still a big question mark if it's going to get there. And either way, though, it's an incredible run befitting the MCU's first decade, right? And now the only thing left to do, the cherry on top of the sundae, is to get Robert Downey Jr. that Oscar nomination. I do think it can be done. And, you know, of course, do it all over again. Good luck, Phase 4, especially without your heavy hitters. And I say that with love. It's going to be interesting. As for the rest of the top 10, Warner Brothers, as you might recall, had hoped that Zachary Levi would be their Ryan Reynolds. And interestingly, Reynolds as Detective Pikachu is performing almost the same as Shazam, like really similarly. Both were down in the high 50th percentile in their second weekends, and in 2 weeks were just under 100 million. So I think Zachary Levi, in retrospect, was a big problem for Shazam, quite frankly, in getting people to go to the theater. I think he's just not a big enough star. It didn't work. And I think that Ryan Reynolds outside of Deadpool continues to be a surprisingly tough sell. interestingly, because he can generate so much social media chatter. Still can't generate those tickets, though. Then, ironically, John Wick 3 took out newcomer A Dog's Journey, the lowest of the W. Bruce Cameron adaptations. I didn't even know this was a trilogy. So I guess because it spans two studios, but I think that's a real marketing fail on, now Universal's part. Meanwhile, it's good news that the stars of The Sun Is Also a Star have sweet TV gigs. As for this coming weekend, we'll see if the Memorial Day weekend curse still haunts Disney as Aladdin finally takes flight. A lot of Three Wishes jokes I'm predicting next weekend. It could do well, though. I think Disney has one of the best marketing departments out there, and I think that they've really stepped up their game in the last couple of, I'd even say days when it comes to promoting Aladdin. I think that even if, we'll see how the movie is. The embargo lifts on Wednesday morning, Eastern Standard Time, but I think it might be one of those things like you just want to see it no matter what, even if it's not great. All right. Also, James Gunn will dip a toe back into the marketplace with Brightburn. He's producing. His brothers wrote the movie, although they're certainly using his name to promote it. So we'll see if that works. It's not expected to do particularly well, but if it overperforms, that could be seen as support for Gunn. So that would be nice for him as he ramps back up with his career. Yesterday, someone said, do you think James Gunn is back? And a friend of mine said, yeah, I do. And I was like, yeah, but I still think there's the other shoe to drop. I think if these next two movies are good, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 and The Suicide Squad, then he will definitely be back. But I think he's certainly back in play. And don't feel bad for Olivia Wilde making her directorial debut, because she's more interested in reviews and awards nominations than she is box office. She's just trying to get on the board for the first time. All right, so that's this week's movie math. Thanks so much for going over the box office with me. I look forward to hearing your thoughts down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.